I turn my camera on. I cut my fingers on the way. And you wasn't polite.
So we're going to talk about pixel art and how to render and animate pixel art in a web browser. We're also going to talk about abstraction and how we can use abstraction to better understand complex systems. So really quick, my name is Vince Allen. I'm a software engineering manager at Spotify. I live in Brooklyn and I work in New York City. You can get in touch with me on Twitter at Vince Allen Vince. And all the code for the demos that you're going to see, you can find at this repo. A quick thing about the code, I'm just using JavaScript, CSS, and the DOM. I'm not using any render extras like Canvas, WebGL, SVG, or Flash, or anything like that.
The Defender sees lots of alien ships. The Defender sees lots of radar blips. Every blip is a ship.
Watch this, I got this code.
On a body snatching trip. And it's up to Defender to save them. Defender, a great Atari game.
Have you played Defender? It's the newest of the smash hit home video games that just keep coming, only from Atari.
He did better than me.
Have you played Atari today?
So leave it to Atari to get a jump on addressing gender issues in the gaming industry. I got my first Atari when I was 9 or 10 years old, and it was the first time I'd ever seen pixel art. And I spent easily hundreds, if not thousands, of hours on this machine. And these are the types of images I was interacting with. And they were simple, and they were an abstraction of the real world, and they were certainly an abstraction of the fantastic worlds depicted on the game's packaging. But given their simplicity, they framed a world where I escaped and explored day after day. And I'll never forget the first time I was able to drive my tank in Atari's combat outside the defined game space, and I suddenly found myself in this empty void. And whether or not this was a bug or if it was intended, it left this impression with me that this game space was limitless. And like the heroic bowler here from Atari's bowling, I stood at the center of a vast universe with no audience to cheer my accomplishments. So fast forward 20 years, and I moved into an open plan Brooklyn apartment with high ceilings and big blank walls. And this poster by Shepard Fairey was dominating the campaign visuals for the Obama campaign in 2008. And I thought it'd be really cool to have this in our apartment. The thing was that Shepard Fairey had stopped selling them, and I wanted it in a bigger format anyway. So I wrote a script that mapped the colors in that poster to the available colors in the Post-it note palette. And this is what I got. And this is then the piece installed in my kitchen. So we had breakfast with Post-it note Obama every morning. This is 7.5 feet wide by 10 feet tall and uses 1,300 Post-its. You remember this GQ cover? This is a 10-foot high Megan Fox made entirely of Post-its. Now, my roommates were starting to get a little nervous about the pattern that was starting to emerge and how I was decorating our place. But I was having fun. And this was the first time I had thought about the art in pixel art. I had previously just interacted with pixel art on screen, but there was a lot of artists actually making pixel art in the real world, in the physical world. This was taken in the East Village in New York. So you had artists making street art. You can see pixel art in design and in fine art. So recently I was in Dumbo. It's a neighborhood in Brooklyn, New York, for the Dumbo Arts Festival. And I saw a lot of great artwork, but this one I really particularly liked. It's the Jumbo Dumbo puppy. And there was actually two. There was one down the street. Now, I never found like an artist statement around this piece, but I think it's really interesting when you manipulate scale like this and you apply abstraction that you would typically associate with pixel art. And I'll never forget when I first saw Anthony Gormley's work. So Anthony Gormley is a sculptor. He's British, and he's installed work all over the world. And I was walking through the Flatiron District in Manhattan, and he had just installed Event Horizon. And he had 31 cast iron figures that he installed on rooftops and in parks all around Manhattan. So I got interested in Antony Gormley, and the more I saw of his work, the more I saw a representation of the human form that reminded me of pixel art. And these are really extreme abstractions that use the cubic form as a metaphor for the body. There's actually an Antony Gormley piece in Singapore. So in the Tower 1 of the Sands, there is this piece that's meant to be both kind of a drawing and a sculpture. It's like this intricate geometric form hanging from the ceiling. But a piece that really stuck with me is something called Allotment. And he made it in the late 90s. He went to Malmo, Sweden, and he asked the inhabitants, there were 300 locals, to offer their measurements. And then he recast their body forms totally in proportion as these two-piece concrete sculptures. And there's holes there for like the eyes and the ears and the mouth and so on. But throughout Gormley's work, he is juxtaposing the inner and outer self. And all of his work, all of his sculptures are typically hollow, and that's meant to suggest that there's an infinity within. So it's up to us, the observer, to fill in what's missing. And then when we do that, we engage with the artist's intent. We commit to understanding what the artist is about, and in some ways we help complete the work. So considering pixel art in a broader sense, I was really inspired by these artists. But as a JavaScript developer, I wanted to figure out how to render pixel art in a web browser. And putting post-it notes up on a wall was a really good lesson for this, because post-it notes, if you think about it, are just giant pixels, and all they need is a space in 2D, a location in 2D space. So they just need an X and Y location, and they need a scale, and they just need a color. So that's just four properties, right? So surely any modern web browser can handle that. And the solution I arrived at is called Bit Shadow Machine. And it uses the web browser's true post-it note equivalent, and that is the CSS box shadow. So I'm going to explain how this works. So what we're going to do is divide the visible area of the browser into a grid. And we're going to put a parent div at the top left corner. And then we're going to hide that div by giving it a width and height of 0. Now, the interesting thing about box shadows is that if their parent is hidden in the sense that it has no dimension, you can still see the box shadows. And so to see this box shadow, all I have to do is give it a x offset and a y offset and up its, amplify its scale and give it a color, and then I can see it. So other cool things about box shadows when it comes to rendering pixel art is we can have n number of box shadows on any parent. And we can have a 2D location, it's all relative to the parents. If I move the parent, I move all the box shadows. They have a blur value, which is really fun to work with. And they have spread property, which we can map to scale. We can display them in RGB or HSL, which is interesting. And we can also add an opacity through the alpha channel. So what this means is that to get what I want, all I need to do is position my box shadows and then just adjust the properties. All right, so I'm going to show you quick demo in the browser. So this is a very simple example. So we just have a box shadow position just like the slide before. And it gets a little more interesting when we actually make them move. So this is the box shadow undergoing a gravity simulation. And if I bring up the developer tools and we can look at the DOM, you can see that I've got this container with my parent element. And if you notice, it's got one box shadow, and there's a step function that is driving the gravity simulation. And then every frame, it just draws the box shadow to a new location. So why? What's the big payoff for this approach? Well, doing this as opposed to kind of using a bunch of DOM elements, we can get a lot more elements moving at 60 frames per second. So this is an example of the same simulation. But now we have 1,000 box shadows animating. So we're close to 60 frames. But if I was doing, this is about 10 times as many objects as if I was doing it with, you know, just regular DOM objects. And I mentioned that there's also a blur that we get for free. So in this one, I'm doing the same simulation, except I'm mapping the magnitude of these items' velocity to a blur to get like a cheap motion blur effect. So the faster they get, the more they blur. And we get that for free. So that's pretty cool. So if I can do this, I can certainly create walking cats. So all this is a group of box shadows that I'm switching back and forth between. So I've grouped, I think, 6 frames of box shadows, and then I'm just cycling through them, hiding and showing as fast as I need them to go. And to do more of this kind of stuff, I actually created a tool called BitShadow Press. And what this lets me do is, if I create, let's say, bitmaps in Photoshop, so I have this like running goat here, I can load them in, and it'll just really quickly interrogate all the images and give me the data that I need to hand off to the machine, and it animates it. So remember I was talking about all the properties that I need? I need, you know, 2D location, color, opacity, scale, and so on. So this thing will generate it for me, and then I can just spend my time actually making characters, and it's up to me to decide then how fast I'd want them to animate. And that also means I can have multiple characters, so I can have mini cats, mini box shadow cats running. This one's walking really fast because he's keeping up with these others that are an all-out sprint. It's amazing. But I've been trying to work on an actual animation, like a narrative. And so this is a story about a little box of milk that has legs, and it runs away from home. He lives on a dairy farm. I've still got some work to do on that. But so we can create little simulations with this technique, and we can create frame by frame animations. But what about doing something a little more complex? What about creating a rendering a tornado in our browser? So I've been really fascinated with tornadoes, probably because I grew up in an area that got them pretty frequently. But there's something kind of interesting about miniaturization. So when we take something really enormous and violent and shrink it down and put it inside a browser, it almost becomes cute. So we're going to create tiny tornadoes in our web browser using box shadows. Now, it's worth understanding what a tornado is. This is a real mini tornado. This is a dust devil. It's just a rotating vertical column of air. But a tornado is like a dust devil. It's a rotating vertical column of air, except that it's connected to something called the supercell. And the supercell is a massive thunderstorm way up in our atmosphere. And tornadoes form when cold air from the supercell rushes down. It meets warm air that creates an area of low pressure. And then the warm air that's rushing up creates condensation in a funnel. And the funnel hits the ground, we have a tornado. And to create one of these in the browser, it's worth breaking down all the core visual components. So we have a base. It's where the tornado touches the ground. We have a debris cloud. So this is all the rocks and dirt and debris and so on that's kicking up. Tornadoes have kind of an armature. They have a form. So you could talk about a tornado having like a spine. And when it weakens, that spine starts to move a little bit. And then when we have a shell, I call it a shell. It's just all the clouds and condensation that's wrapped around the vertical axis. So we're going to build this step by step. I'll show you how I did it. So I said I needed a base. So this is, if you can see this little red dot is meant to represent where we're touching the ground. And it's moving according to, I'm using Perlin noise to give it an offset every frame from the edges of the screen. Perlin noise is just an algorithm that gives me a natural looking sequence of numbers between -1 and 1. And I use that to just kind of animate this guy and have him drift around naturally. And then I'm going to parent a debris cloud to that base. And my debris cloud is really just a bunch of divs with box shadows that have been severely blurred out, and I'm randomly throwing around. It's like a little mini particle system. And then I'm going to have a spine. So to start with the spine, we're going to use an easing function and go from the bottom of the browser to the top, or the bottom of our little world here to the top. And we want to have a higher concentration of joints at the bottom. But there's no tornado looks like this, where it's straight up. Tornadoes typically take on some type of curvature. So I'm using purlin noise again to offset the nodes of the spine from the vertical axis. And then we need a shell. And so for the shell, the first step is just to kind of represent the shell with these divs. I've just rounded their corners so that you can tell the difference from the spine nodes. But they are parented to the spine nodes, and they're just oscillating back and forth across them. And you can see that there's a higher concentration, and they're actually oscillating faster toward the bottom. Now, to then bring this home, to make it look realistic, we need to get rid of all of these placeholders, right? So all of the armature, and we need to go ahead and expand the shell by using the blur values on their box shadows. And this is what you get. So I've randomized this so that as I reload, I get, you know, different tornado shapes and so on. If I zoom in, you can see that it's not bad for a bunch of divs. But what about the pixel art version? All right, so the high resolution version is nice, but this one is kind of reveals more of the vortex involved, right? And you can see that this is just using strictly box shadows. And I feel like I'm going to bring down the speakers. It's an intense tornado. So the more I started doing these simulations, the more I actually wanted to break out of the browser and render them as video. And to do this, I used Photoshop and I used Node.js. So Node and Photoshop, they work together in this thing called Adobe Generator. So the latest version of Photoshop ships with Generator, and it allows you to write Photoshop plugins using JavaScript. So I took my simulations and recorded the data for every frame, so every property for every object at every frame, and then wrote a Photoshop plugin that iterated over all that data and then drew the frames over again, just at whatever resolution I wanted. And what's great is that I could actually take advantage of Photoshop filters. So I could create gradients, I could, more importantly, create motion blur that's accurate. So I can make my plugin aware of the vector representing the item's velocity, and then use that to actually calculate an accurate motion blur. You get something that looks more realistic and it's not just kind of a halo. And then I can output this to video. So this is the same pixel art version just as HD video. So like I said, the high resolution version was nice, but you know, when you abstract it, you actually get a sense of the mechanics of a tornado. And the important part is the conservation of angular momentum, basically. Mass that's closer to the rotational axis is going to rotate faster, and that's what gives it this kind of upside down pear shape, because as the mass moves up the tornado, it starts to lose energy and starts to separate from the rotational axis and dissipate and get larger. Valentino Breitenberg. So we're going to take a method that he used to look at some other complex systems. So Valentino Breitenberg was an Italian neuroscientist, and he was interested in studying how human beings developed intelligence and reasoning. And instead of looking at human beings, he started with insects. And he thought that by looking at simple brains, he would understand or be able to identify the building blocks to our cognitive evolution. And he was really careful about his methodology. He wanted to look at the inner workings of simple systems as a key to, or a path to, understanding and answering larger questions. He wanted to understand our brain's building blocks and our brain's evolution to understand how we think. So along the way, he created something called Breitenberg vehicles. And a Breitenberg vehicle is a very simple vehicle with a sensor and a motor. And The sensor is tuned to specific stimulus. And whenever it encounters the stimulus, it activates the motor. So imagine that this sensor was tuned to temperature. If the vehicle got around something hot, it would then activate the motor in proportion to how hot that stimulus is. If it was around something cold, it would then slow down. So there's other types of vehicles that he describes. One with two sensors, and it's wired to motors on the same side of the sensors. So that means that when it's around a stimulus, let's say it's light, the sensor closest to the light will activate, and then the motor on the nearest side, on the near side of the sensor, will then turn, causing the vehicle to turn away from the stimulus. Another vehicle is very similar, except it uses cross-side wiring. What this means is that the near side sensor will activate when it's closest, to the stimulus, but it turns the motor that's on the opposite side, and this causes the vehicle to turn toward the light. So if you're observing this system, you would say that the vehicle on the left doesn't like light. It tries to avoid light, while the vehicle on the right, it likes light. Now, I was in the Art Science Museum a couple of days ago, and at the end of the Da Vinci exhibition, they actually had an experiment with these types of robots. I think, as personal robotics gets more accessible to makers, people are experimenting with these ideas, and these robots are operating under the same kind of principles that Breitenberg describes. But we're going to do an experiment. All right? So we're going to create a simulation using these types of vehicles, and I'm going to call the vehicle an agent. And the agent has a sensor, and whenever it's around something that it's tuned to, the sensor is going to activate, and the agent is going to either turn toward the sensor or go away. So I'm going to show you just a really quick example, something very simple. So you can see our little agent is kind of navigating around. Whenever it's around something that it's attracted to, it'll turn toward it. So let's take that a step further. We're going to create a simulation called sheep versus wolves. And the wolves are represented by the orange agents. And the sheep are represented by the tan agents. And they both have sensors, but they're tuned to each other. And so the wolves, whenever they encounter a sheep, they pursue the sheep. Whenever the sheep senses a wolf, it tries to avoid the wolf and run away. So what happens when a wolf catches a sheep? Right, it's going to turn it into a wolf. So we're just going to get more wolves. So let's see what happens. So we're going to have wolves on the sheep on the left, like 200 or 100 or so, and then one wolf on the right. So the wolves win. So I rendered this as video. We may want to drop the picture-in-picture for this. So it's just a bloodbath. So what's going on here? Well, this is an example of a positive feedback loop. So a positive feedback loop is when you have an occurrence of a behavior that then causes an exponential increase in that behavior. So basically, wolves catch sheep and they turn them into wolves. And you end up with a system that's totally out of balance. So we just end up with a world full of wolves. So how do we approach something that's a little more balanced? So we're going to introduce some negative feedback. So we're going to say that when a wolf catches a sheep, there's a small chance that he'll turn the sheep into a zombie. So we've got our zombie agents right here. And the zombies then pursue the wolves. And if they catch them, they're going to turn them into sheep. So let's see what happens when we run that. Browser. the zombie. Right, so we're left with a world full of zombies and sheep. So let's see what that looks like in video. And what's nice about doing this in video is we can have a lot more objects involved. See, the wolves are trying to hang on. Trying to hang on, there's one left. And then we're left with just zombies and sheep. So what's happening here? The wolves are so obsessed with getting away from the zombies, preoccupied, that they can't catch any more sheep and they die out. So how do we get to something that's like an equilibrium? What we're going to do is we're going to let the sheep pursue the zombies. So when a sheep catches a zombie, it changes it back into a sheep. So I'm going to go straight to video for this one. You can almost see the moment where they hit an equilibrium. And what's nice is you also have these bursts where a lot of transformations happen at once, where these gangs of similar agents transform rapidly into other ones. So I could let this run forever, and I've let it run for hours actually in the browser, and it still maintains an equilibrium. Termites. Termites are incredible builders. Looking at these termite mounds in Australia, you might think that termites have some innate sense of architecture. But we know that termites have really simple brains and they're only capable of executing really simple instructions. So how do they create such complex structures? So this question was on the mind of Michael Resnick, who's an MIT professor, when he wrote a book called Turtles, Termites, and Traffic Jams. And in that book, he describes a simulation where he has termites and wood chips. And the termites are in a defined area, and the wood chips at the beginning are distributed evenly throughout the workspace. And the termites just randomly walk around their environment. Whenever they hit a wood chip, they pick it up. And then they randomly walk again until they hit another wood chip, and they drop it. And then they continue on their way and randomly walk. Now, the whole goal for the termites is to create one pile, to organize everything's been randomly distributed into one single pile. So I thought it'd be really cool to try to do this with JavaScript and box shadows. So this is an example of that simulation running. I'm going to zoom in so you can see the termites in action. So you can tell they're picking up and dropping off and picking up and dropping off. One thing you should notice, they're already starting to make little piles. Like almost immediately, you can kind of start identify the definition of some of these little piles. Now, if I let this run long enough, they will create one pile. But we're going to be here for a while. I have a few minutes left. So I created a time lapse so you can actually see what happens. You can see eventually they get to these dominant piles. And the dominant piles kind of compete for wood chips. And then finally we get to a single pile. Now, I thought, all right, that's interesting. It's a limited space. We have a lot of ratio to termites to wood chips is actually pretty high. So let's make it a little more difficult for them. So I made a simulation where there's 3,500 wood chips. In this one there was 1,000. And I doubled the work area, and this is what I got. So again, we have some dominant piles, and eventually one. one lives. Now, what's happening here is if a pile is large or larger or starts to form, there's a greater probability that it's going to acquire more wood chips. And so if you just play that out over time, eventually you're going to get one pile. But that's, you know, I let this run for 4 days to get this. And there's over, I just screenshotted these, and I had like over 100,000 screenshots compressed into 30 seconds. So how can we make this more efficient? How can we make the termites more efficient so they can do this faster? Well, we can take a lesson from the sheep and the wolves and give them sensors. So I gave the termites a 5-pixel sensor. So if it encounters a wood chip within 5 pixels of itself, it'll actually turn toward it. And this helps it actually find wood chips, and then it also helps them figure out where to drop them off. So let's see an example of that in the browser. So we've got a bigger space. But almost immediately, you can see some interesting things happen. So you see over here, this one is starting to create a path. And they're creating like these little identifiable structures. So rather than wait forever to see how this turns out, it created another time lapse. So by enhancing, just slightly enhancing, their awareness of their own environment, we dramatically change what they start to build. It starts to look like a patchwork, like a weaving. And they also, it just enhances the level of design that they exhibit. So I thought, all right, 5 pixels is cool. What would happen if we went to 100 pixels? And what would we get? And so this is it. So now they're starting to create a network. It's almost, you almost get a sense that they're aware of each other. They're creating paths, they're creating little highways. It's not too hard to understand what's happening here. So when the termite drops off its pixel and turns around to pick up another one, it has a sensor, and the nearest pixel is going to be the one that it goes for, and that's almost always the one that's directly behind it. And so they end up creating these little chains, you know. But it gives you this impression that there's kind of a higher order at work here. So with regards to pixel art, you know, I'm using big squares, and I'm using kind of an 8-bit style to represent this whole simulation. But I'm not trying to say that this, let's say this last frame is pixel art in and of itself. So I'm using this style more to symbolize the investigative method that we used to make sense of what was going on. So if this was a real termite system, there'd be thousands of variables at play. But since we were able to distill it down to its essential components, we can see how a positive feedback loop and massive parallelism can create global order out of just a set of simple local rules. So as observers, we're a lot like the heroic boulder who is trapped in a limitless but very simple world. And when we did the sheep versus wolf simulation, I could have labeled these anything. They don't have to be sheep or wolves. I just did that as a conscious action on my part. If I had not labeled them, you would have come up with your own interpretation of what was going on. And then when we look at Gormley's work, his intent hinges on us completing the work to fill in the gaps, to do it with what we bring from inside of us. And that's what I love about pixel art. It gives us the opportunity to complete the other side of an artist's creative impulse. So it's a gift that we receive when we cross the boundary from our high-resolution exterior world into the boundless interpretive freedom of our own imaginations. So thanks for listening. I didn't show any actual code, but you can look at the code at the repo for all the demos. And there's links to Gormley and to the book that I mentioned by Michael Resnick. And that's it.
Wow. Thanks, Vince. I'm personally blown away. Post-it notes, nature. Do check out his Flora.js.
Yes.
And he has a lot of simulations there. Maybe one question.
Vince, can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Thanks for your talk. I thought it was amazing.
Sure.
Besides the getting like motion blur for free when you approached your rendering technique by using CSS box shadows, which is ingenious, have you found any other advantages over using this box shadow technique as a visualization method over something like, say, processing?
Right. So processing, there's things like Open Frameworks, Sender, you know, these things that could probably do all of this in real time, but you're not doing it in JavaScript, you know. And so I wanted to be really true to doing this in a browser, and also I wanted to stay true to this original intent of like minimalism, you know, and just really boiling everything down to its most essential components, right? And so what is native to the browser, you know? So I just decided, all right, well, I'll stick with JavaScript. And processing is an amazing tool. I love using it. And I think that you could actually, you know, do a lot of this in that. But, you know, JavaScript is also, it's a really fun to try to figure it out with JavaScript and CSS, so.
Awesome, thank you. Yeah.
Right, thank you. Thank you, Vince, once again. So whether it's music or art, go and talk to him.